And so as this is a totally different method of ventilating babies, we also need to learn a little bit about the mechanisms involved, how this modality achieves exchange of gases in and out of the lung. And high frequency can be created by various mechanisms. So different manufacturers use different technologies to create this high frequency. So a little bit we'll be discussing about the various devices that are used and the mechanisms that they do employ, what we can call as the various kinds of high frequency ventilators. And we'll dwell a little bit upon playing around with the parameters. Okay, so how do we adjust oxygenation? How do we adjust CO2 elimination? Those things. And finally, a little bit word upon, okay, so what does the evidence say? What is the place of high frequency ventilation right now in the NICU? What is its scope? So where do you plan to apply high frequency in our day-to-day medical practice? So that is going to be the outline of this talk. So starting with a very primary question, okay, so this lecture is coming on almost the fag end of the workshop, right? So we discuss a lot about the various modalities of ventilation. And every day we keep hearing newer methods of ventilation coming in. So we do have reasonably good and more than enough modes of ventilation available already in conventional ventilation. So why to have one more mode? The purpose is simple. So whenever we're talking about different modes of ventilation or new modes of ventilation coming in, so we are just trying to minimize the injury that happens because of ventilation. All the modes of ventilation, including the very basic mode, IMV, are capable of achieving gas exchange. So ventilation is all about giving oxygen and removing carbon dioxide. So every mode is capable of doing it, but the problem is many times we may overdo things. It's very, very difficult to keep things under control. And we know this simple process of ventilation, especially as it is a positive pressure ventilation, unlike the negative pressure ventilation that happens in nature. So the pressure we use to deliver these tidal volumes, the volume that gets transmitted in and out, the flow of the gases, the presence of an endotracheal tube, which is a foreign body there. So many things can cause trauma to the lung. I'm not going into the details of the pathophysiology of what we call as a ventilator-induced lung injury. We know it comprises these various terminologies, just what I described: barotrauma, volutrauma, rheotrauma, biotrauma, telectrauma, and so on. But of these various traumas that we know of, if you ask me which is the major contributor or the number one bad guy is the volutrauma. So if you're delivering more volume, obviously that damages the premature lung, and it can result in long-term implications. So that's why we bring in many modalities like how do we optimize the pressures that are being delivered. And so we are bringing in various volume-targeted ventilations, and even now we are even talking about volume-controlled ventilations. So this is another method, so which is brought in mainly from the perspective of protecting the lung. So of the various modes of lung protective strategies that we are using, so most more or less, especially one is controlling the volume, the amount of tidal volume. So we are trying to restrict it or make sure we are using the least tidal volume that is possible. But we know that this concept of volume has come in only late. So even now, we are. I hope that you will know the difference between a volume targeting and volume controlled ventilation. So unlike the ventilation in older children and adults, where primarily just we are setting the tidal volume as the primary parameter, that's what is called as a volume controlled ventilator. We are for a long time, even now we are using only pressure based or pressure controlled ventilators. And we are using volume only to regulate the pressures. Whenever the pressure is, if the volume delivered is more, we want the ventilator to come down on the pressure and vice versa. So, as we are primarily as neonates, in neonatal units, as we are using pressure-based ventilations. So the lung protective strategy is all about, Okay, so ventilating, the injury happens at the level of alveoli. There could be some injury to the airways as well. But when you talk about these long-term problems, the primary injury is happening at the level of alveoli, and we know it is a developing alveoli. It's in a very immature state. So this injury to the alveoli will be more if the alveoli, at the alveolar level, if there is a, if the, either if the alveoli is not optimally inflated, it means if you are ventilating an alveoli which is collapsed, or if it leads to over-distension. Or the third one, okay, if you allow this alveoli to just go between these two phases, so during ventilation, it goes for collapse at times, some amount of collapse, and it gets over this at times. So moving between opening and closed stage, that's also not good for the alveoli and can result in more injury. So the lung protective strategies are all about using, sorry, I'll just take a pointer, just give me a moment. So is my screen still clear, or is it switched on by mistake, something else?
I think.
Okay, yeah, fine, fine. So we are back. So I hope it's okay now. Okay, so this is what I was discussing about. See, this is just a pressure volume curve or the compliance curve. So there is a zone, the lower zone, where primarily the alveoli remains in the state of de-recruitment. It's not optimally open, in a state of atelectasis. Whereas we're using on the, if we keep on increasing the pressure at higher levels of pressure, we may enter the zone of over-distension. So the whole idea of protecting the lung is we use this optimal zone or the safest zone for ventilation, where there is neither de-recruitment and nor over-distension. And the challenge is in, as this is a very dynamic process, the challenge is in some movement always will be happening, but can we just remain or keep all those movements happening only in this narrow zone, not allowing the alveoli to move neither here nor there? So that is the challenge. So that is where this mode of ventilation, high frequency, is very appealing. So what is high frequency? Simple definition, the name itself says frequency stands for rates. When you are using rates which are very, very high compared to the physiological rates of respiration. So we know neonates do have a higher rate compared to the other age groups. The normal rate is around 40 to 60. By definition, if you're having a rate of more than 150, means more than 2.5 to 3 times the normal rates, if you start somewhere anything more than 150, then we call it as a high frequency. Why somebody has to raise the rate? So ultimately, we all know when we talk about gas exchange is a product of two things. So one is the respiratory rate multiplied by the tidal volume, the amount of gas that moves in and out with each and every breath. So when you're targeting, we want to play, we want to keep the tidal volume to the least possible, minimal, right? So whenever we need to, we are coming down on the tidal volume. Obviously, if you have to achieve proper or adequate minute ventilations, you have to use higher rates. So that is where this strategy comes in. We are going to use very, very small tidal volumes to the extent that this tidal volume is even less than the normal physiological dead space present there. So with such a small volumes, negligible volumes, multiplied by a very high rate, can we achieve the same minute ventilation which is achieved in a conventional ventilation. That's what high frequency is all about. So again, just a recap, reiteration of what we just discussed. We're using very high respiratory rates. As we are using very high rates, we prefer to use the term frequency rather than the actual rates here. So I said that we start with something like 1 hertz is equal to 60 breaths. I said that by definition, it should be something like, it starts with something like more than 3 times that of a normal rate. So that's a 3 hertz, rate of around 180. So 3 to 25 hertz is the usual operational frequency that we may be using in a high frequency ventilator. Then second is very important. So we are going to create a continuous distancing pressure, something just like of a CPAP. So this is not going to be like a conventional ventilator where there is an inspiration and expiration, where huge movements take place between inspiration and expiration. So just like CPAP, there will be continuous pressure delivered. On top of this, we are just going to superimpose very, very small vibrations at the level of the lung, which will get into the alveoli. So imagine alveoli, which is just getting opened up, and then just the valves of the alveoli simply vibrating, rather than the alveoli opening and closing. That is what is high frequency is all about. So I'll show, I'll have some videos where you can understand this concept well. Before we get there, this is very interesting. So is this form of ventilation a totally unphysiological one? Or in other words, are there species in nature who really use this method of high frequency ventilation? So it looks so. So we all have observed dogs. Dogs are not always using high frequency. You have dogs are mammals. They do inspire and they do expire normally. But you might have observed at times, especially when the dog is panting, just look into this video and just mainly hear into the sound. So we can just understand, right? See, just look into the number of breaths the dog is making per minute. So it's a very, very fast rate. Obviously, it looks like even a time available for one breath is much, much less. So very small volumes only are going to move in and out. So this was an inspiration for the, forerunners who invented high frequency ventilation. So they got inspired from nature. Okay, so this is an electron microscopic picture of what is really happening at the level of alveoli. The first video that I'm about to show is about conventional ventilation. This is not high frequency ventilation. Let's see what happens to the alveoli when we are in conventional ventilation. So you do see that the PEEP is zero here. So what happens when there is no PEEP? So during inspiration, the alveoli are opening, but during expiration, most of the alveoli are getting collapsed. So this is a diseased lung. This is not a normal lung. So when we start increasing the PWP, so don't look into the numbers. The concept is all about what happens with rising PWP. Okay. So you start seeing slowly more and more alveoli are remaining open even at the end of expiration. So this is what we call as recruitment. So as we keep on increasing the PWP, just see now the PWP has become 15. So we start recruiting more and more alveoli. Now we see it looks like we have reached a state where almost all the alveoli are recruited, they're remaining open. And inspiration and expiration is happening nicely. This is what conventional ventilation is all about, but we are not using such high amount of PWP. And the limitation also will be like the time available for inspiration. Okay, let's see what happens in high frequency. This is what I was asking you people to conceptualize in your mind. So imagine how an alveoli will be in high frequency. So here is a depiction of your imagination is what we just discussed. See, alveoli or this lung on a high frequency ventilator. No inspiration or expiration. Some continuous distending pressure that keeps the alveoli open. So all the alveoli are open. And then on top of this, a little vibration is just added upon. So just like a pulsating alveoli, alveoli are remaining also. So what are the principles here? Again, those three principles, right? First is about recruitment, a very good recruited alveoli. Second, no de-recruitment. We are not allowing the alveoli to go in for de-recruitment. Unlike the previous video, where especially when you're using low PEEPs, the alveoli kept opening and closing. So that is the advantage of using high frequency ventilation. So I think now you all will agree with me that at least by design, going by the basic principles what we discussed so far, high frequency ventilation seems to be the least injurious because of the principles, as it uses a very, very small tidal volume, so there could not be any volute trauma, and it achieves a good lung recruitment. So we are operating in a zone. We saw a picture, right, of a pressure volume compliance curve, neither the top or zone or nor the zone below. We are just in the safest zone, maintaining optimal lung volume, and we are not moving towards the upper area of lung overdistension. Okay, so we have understood the concept of high frequency now. But the question is that if you are going to use volumes which are very, very low, which are even less than the tidal, the dead space, then how a gas which is a volume of gas which cannot even cross the dead space, how it gets moves into the level of alveoli? So that's very, people will be curious, right? So that is where, just we won't spend much time, hardly so 2 minutes. This is more of a theoretical interest, but some of you might be fellows here who may be interested in understanding these mechanisms. See, even in a conventional ventilation, so it is not that the air is moving in and out continuously at all levels. There is a mechanism called bulk convection. Bulk convection simply means a large movement of gas. So in the upper part, up to the major levels of bronchi and the alveoli surrounding them, it's always there is a big movement during inspiration and expiration. But when you come to the level of gas which is there inside the alveoli and beyond, it's more about a concept of diffusion. So what is diffusion? Diffusion is the concept of an exchange happening just because of a concentration gradient. See what happened, what at the level of alveoli, what is the, how is the concentration gradient for oxygen? Obviously the air that is coming in has got a high concentration of oxygen compared to the air that is coming out from the CO2 is coming out from the capillaries. And the reverse is true for CO2. The gas that is coming in has got very less amount of CO2, whereas the gas that is the CO2, more CO2 is coming out of the capillaries. So even if there is no bulk movement, if the air, even if it remains static at the level of alveoli, obviously because of this concentration gradient, so we can understand oxygen will start moving towards the blood vessels and CO2 will start moving towards the outside. So that is what we call a concept of a molecular diffusion. So this to a larger extent operates in the very low parts of the our respiratory system, even in the so-called conventional ventilation with inspiration and expiration. So in one word, if you want to understand the mechanism in high frequency, it's more or less like, see, this concept of diffusion, where it's more like air is based on concentration gradient. Can we just extend this concept concept of diffusion even to the upper airways throughout? So all that it is required is what? A good mixing of the inspiratory and expiratory gas. I always use this example. Just see, imagine, let us say we have got 2 glasses. So they are filled with, let's say, one glass is colored red and the other glass is colored blue. So you just want to, blue stands for gas rich in CO2. The red or pink stands for some gas which is rich in oxygen. When you want to replace the glass which has got the blue with red, there are 2 options, right? One is what? So you just throw away the blue, and then fully pour this pink into that one. The second option is what? Again, you just pour the pink one into this blue one, but you keep on stirring it well. If there is a continuous mixing, obviously it's going to get exchanged, right? Blue and pink are going to get exchanged because of the concentration, because there was no pink there in that glass, and vice versa for the other gas. Okay, so there are 6 primary mechanisms which are proposed for gas exchange in high frequency. And these mechanisms are operating at different levels in the airways. It is not that all these mechanisms are operating at all levels of our respiratory system. So we'll just take up one by one. First is a simple, just like it happens in a normal respiration. This is very, very, preliminary, or this is the least important method, because it can happen only in, if some alveoli are really situated very close to the airways, and if they are accessible to the so-called sub-dead space tidal volume, it is quite possible that the air reaches up to that level of alveoli, okay, which is hardly there should be any such alveoli, but still there may be a few alveoli very close to the major airways, where just by the process of convection, bulk convection, some gas exchange can happen. Okay, that is self-explanatory. Let's focus on 2 and 3, which are the major mechanisms. So the second one is called Taylor dissolution. The concept is very, very simple. Maybe many, so the only the name is annoying. Whenever it gets named after somebody, we get confused, right? That too, when the fellow happens to be a non-Indianer, somebody from outside. So what did Taylor found actually? So look into these graphs one by one. So there is a piston or there is a movement of a substance. So, we are just inserting one substance into another substance which is existing already. Obviously, this is inspiratory air and the other one is the expiratory gas which is coming out from there. If you're doing it in a very slow fashion, just see, it still forms an arrowhead, but the arrowhead is very, very small. But if you're going to use very fast movements of this piston, we are going to use it to and fro very fastly, what happens? So it becomes something like a jet. This is the shape of the arrowhead. And imagine the same arrowhead in a three-dimensional fashion. This is two-dimensional, right? This is a cut section. Just imagine, what is it like? It's something like a whole cone of inspired gas is getting inserted into the expired gas. How the cone is formed? Because of the very fast movement. What is the advantage of the cone being so long? So this is during inspiration, during when it goes in this direction. The moment the movement stops, what happens? There is a complete mixing of these two. They become one chamber. There is no movement here. It is stopped. So if it is going to be very slow, like what happens in a bulk convection, not much of gas exchange or mixing is possible. As we are using very, very small volumes, but if you are using very high rates, if you are doing this very rapidly, then this almost penetrates into this. And if you look into three-dimensionally, you can imagine the amount of surface available for mixing up of these two gases. So this much, almost the whole of the surface is available for excellent mixing of these two substances. That is what we call as Taylor dispersion. So as we have understood Taylor dispersion, it's very easy to understand the third concept, asymmetric velocity profile, which is just an extension of the Taylor dispersion. We just saw that how a rapid push of a gas can form a narrow head. And what we saw in Taylor dispersion is that when this movement stops, there is a complete mixture. That's true. But one more thing, what happens is that actually, if you're using very, very high rates, the two repeatedly, one over the other, it is not that the whole thing, up to this point, it participates in mixing. But there is a very, the tip of the arrowhead escapes this process and just keeps penetrating and it keeps moving through. So what happens ultimately? In every movement, in and out, a small chunk, that's that only the tip of the arrow escapes this process, this process of mixing. And it keeps moving forward at the same velocity in which it was traveling earlier. Now you just see. So what happens when you keep on pumping the gas, it's even small volumes repeatedly. This is a representation of all the small arrowheads. So we create two different velocities of movement within the same tube. There is only one tube, but within the tube, in the center of the tube, we do have a gas moving at a faster velocity or a higher velocity, where the velocity is happening towards, or the movement is happening towards the alveoli, whereas in the space around, so in the peripheries of the same tube, the movement is in the reverse. So beautiful, right? The same tube, some movement happens in the middle, which is a faster movement towards the alveoli, which carries oxygen in. And in the peripheries, it's a reverse movement, which brings out the CO2 inside. But if you look at the individual volumes, they are so, so small. But as a combination, all these arrowheads make this movement possible. That's what we call as asymmetric velocity profile. Others are still very simple. So it's not that always the gas has to come from the trachea or the airways. At times, even gas can move from one alveoli to other alveoli because different alveoli will have different time constants. So gas exchange possible from one alveoli to the other. That's what we call as a pendulum effect. The last one, simply, we already discussed what is molecular diffusion. We know about some spaces like those, so some connections exist between even at the level of alveoli. So it's not that just like pendulum is just moving this way. Whereas when there are connections, we can call it as a collateral ventilation. So this is just a recap. So primarily in the upper airway, it is happening by convection. And we know that even in conventional ventilation, diffusion is happening in the lower part. But in conventional ventilation, the middle part is only about convection. Whereas in high frequency ventilation, we are just bringing in a lot of mixing using these asymmetric velocity profiles and pendulum and Taylor dispersion. So it's a combination of convection and diffusion. We are moving this diffusion well ahead in the respiratory system. That's how these things work. I think more than we'll skip all these slides. I think we have discussed enough. For want of time, we'll just rush through. Okay. So now let's talk about various types of high frequency. Types means high frequency is only one concept. There is only one high frequency ventilation. Whenever we say types, there are types of high frequency ventilators. That means how a machine produces high frequency. That is different from one machine to the other machine based upon the technology that is being used. So this is just a pictorial representation of a conventional ventilator. We all know there is a valve at the expirator limb. And so this valve, by closing and opening, it produces the two pressures, PAP and PWD. So this is one of the commonly used methods available, high frequency, very powerful high frequency ventilators called high frequency oscillators. So what do you mean by oscillation? So see, whenever it's something like a pendulum, right? So there is either a wheel which is rotating, and this wheel, rotating wheel, is attached to a piston. Sorry if you're not able to see the piston clearly, there is a piston here which is attached to this wheel. As this rotates, this piston moves very fast up and down. So imagine, just we are adding this piston movement into the routine tubing of a ventilator. So on top of, there is no separate flow. The same flow of a ventilator, inspirator limb is there, expirator limb is there. We just super add a piston movement. So when the piston pushes gas, that gas moves in. When the piston moves away, it's going to suck gas. So it has both ways are active here. So coming down, when the piston is coming down, the gas moves in this direction. When the piston is moving away, the gas moves in the other direction. This is high frequency oscillation. Okay. So what is a high frequency jet ventilation? So again, just here the concept is a bit different. We are using a separate flow. This is the routine flow of a ventilator tubing. There is a separate flow, and this flow is delivered, small amounts of flow is delivered through a jet nozzle. So small chunks of gas are repeatedly superimposed on the flow which is happening in the normal ventilator circuit. So you can just imagine that there are no two phases. Here it is only a jet of gas coming out. It cannot take gas back in here. So this is a one-way system. That's what we call as an. So in a high frequency oscillator, both inspiration and expiration are active. Whereas in all other forms, as they are giving only in one direction, there is no way air can go in the reverse, it's called a high frequency. This is a high frequency jet. If you're using a valve to interrupt this flow, to create these jets, then that is called a high frequency flow interrupter. Don't need to worry much about these terminologies. Okay. So that's the comparison. If you remember only one point, that is enough at the moment. In all other, when somebody calls a method, this is actually not a high frequency. Whenever we call a high frequency positive pressure ventilation, the same conventional ventilator, if your ventilator is capable of delivering very high rates using only the piston which is there, the valve which is sitting at the expiratory end. So the same valve, if it can function at rates more than 150, that is called high frequency positive pressure. There is no any additional mechanism. That is high frequency positive pressure. If you are using a jet nozzle to insert chunks of air using a separate flow, so getting superimposed on a ventilator flow, that is high frequency jet. If you're going to use a flow interrupter to create that chunks of air, it is a flow interrupter. And if you're using an oscillator, you're circulating either a vibrating drum or a moving wheel, which moves the piston in and out, then that is called high frequency oscillator, where the expiration also becomes active. Okay. So just a quick go through of some of the common ventilators which are available in India, which are used for high frequency ventilation. So this is the SensorMedix 3100A, which is a kind of an oscillator. So this ventilator can provide only high frequency oscillation. It cannot be used for giving conventional ventilation. So see, here sits the drum which vibrates, and a piston is attached to it which starts moving. There is only one tube coming out here. So oscillator. So I don't know, we don't have time to discuss the various details. Okay, no issues. It's not very important. So this is a Dräger baby lock, which has a feature of an. But Dräger baby lock, what is the mechanism in Dräger baby lock? Dräger baby lock uses the same solenoid valves. Solenoid valves are the valves which are sitting at the expiratory end. But they are manufacturing a very good valve where the valve can move very fast and can provide very high rates, the rates of a high frequency. That is what is in. There's a simple same ventilator valve in conventional ventilation is used for delivering high frequency in Dräger baby lock. That's why actually they have made some improvisations in the new model. See, this is, I think, is the next Dräger model. some improvisations have been made in the valve because the earlier baby lug model was not capable of delivering high frequency to bigger babies. It was okay for delivering high frequency for smaller babies. The problem is it is not such a powerful oscillator like in sensormatics. Okay, this is the VN500, the latest model of Dräger. Again, the principles are the same, more or less, with some improvisation in the valve technology. That's all. SLE 5000, another commonly used high frequency ventilator in India. This is interesting. Here actually there is no valve. What they are using is two different, what to say, directions of flow. The flow is reversed during the flow is generating the jet, and there are two different flows. One is one gives flow in one direction, the other one gives flow in the other direction, thereby creating the same effect, something like that of a valve. So we'll discuss this in detail if time permits later, but just imagine this is a totally different technology, SLE 5000. Okay, and of course Sophie from Stefan, again just like your sensormatics, a very good oscillator, and the Accutronics machine. Accutronics is also just like so these three are one kind, the Accutronics, Stefan, Sophie, and sensormatics 3100 are typical high frequency oscillatory ventilators which use a drum and a piston to deliver. So I think we have discussed the most essential things already. Let's skip this slide. We'll just move on to the clinical parameters. So clinical, the knobs that we adjust in a high frequency are in fact very, very simple and not at all complicated. They're even much simpler when we make a comparison to the conventional ventilation. So what are they? There is only one pressure which is called as the mean airway pressure. No pip or peep here, because we are going to deliver only one pressure throughout the respiratory cycle, which is called as the mean airway pressure. And then obviously the rate at which this ventilator is going to work, respiratory rate, is called as a frequency here. And let's discuss the fourth first, amplitude. Okay, so let's just in a moment we'll get to what is frequency, difference between frequency and amplitude. Flow, FiO2 on inspiratory time are standard settings in most of the in any ventilator. See, this is what happens from the graph, you can easily understand. So we are opening up the lung. Just see what is happening at the level of alveoli. Just imagine the same electron microscopic picture, right? So here the alveoli are closed. We are using a pressure to open up the alveoli that is called as the mean airway pressure. And that pressure remains stable throughout during both the phases of inspiration and expiration. We are just giving some vibrations. So what is the number of vibrations per second is or per minute, whatever it is happening, that is called as the frequency, number of vibrations. Okay, now we see three vibrations happening in this short period. Okay, that is the frequency. What is the amplitude? There is a movement, there is an oscillation happening. What is the extent or magnitude of this? Is it happening up to this point? It can go even up to here, right? That is what we call as a high amplitude. So the movement that happens at the valves of the alveoli, so what is the magnitude of those movements? Are they moving more, are they moving less in one cycle? That is called amplitude. I think this is self-explanatory, all these terms, amplitude, frequency. So let's get to a very important business now. Okay, we started with saying that ventilation is all about oxygenation and carbon dioxide elimination. So same principles of conventional ventilation. So what are the determinants of oxygenation? The mean airway pressure and FiO2 and inspiratory time. These three are the determinants, right? Even in a conventional ventilation. So the same principles, at least in conventional ventilation, you have to calculate the MAP, because you have to use a formula to calculate mean airway pressure, because there are two pressures used. Here there is only one pressure used, mean airway pressure. That's a direct determinant of oxygenation. High mean airway pressure means it will increase oxygenation. If you decrease MAP, the oxygenation will come down. FaO2, simple, directly proportionate to oxygenation. Inspiratory time, if there is more inspiratory time, the oxygenation will be more. But okay, we don't play around with this parameter more. If you remember even these two, that is more than enough for the moment. Carbon dioxide elimination. So carbon dioxide elimination is what it is directly related to the tidal volume. In a conventional ventilation, we talk about delta P, the difference between the inspiratory pressure and the expiratory pressure and the rate. So whereas here we don't talk about any pressure. Okay, it's only about these two parameters. The movement that is happening on the valves of alveoli. What is the number of movements happening, which is the frequency, and what are the extent of these movements happening, which is amplitude. Number is frequency and the extent of movements is amplitude. These two are the determinants of carbon dioxide elimination. The most important point to remember is that, which is in contrast to conventional ventilation, is, see, we know that rate is the one which is a significant regulator. of carbon dioxide elimination in conventional ventilation. But as far as high frequency ventilation is concerned, the most important parameter which has got a major impact on carbon dioxide elimination is the amplitude rather than the frequency. Frequency also brings in changes in CO2, but the changes are, the proportion of changes it brings about are small compared to the changes that are brought about by changes in amplitude. So what are the learning point? Whenever you want to play with the CO2, you play with amplitude and not with frequency, because it doesn't give us much advantages. Okay, this is very interesting again. So see, these two, there is no overlap here. If you're touching the pressure, for example, PAP in a conventional ventilator, it will affect both oxygenation and CO2 elimination, because it changes, it affects, there is a change in MAP, which has an impact on oxygenation. There is also a change in delta P. So, but here, totally there is a decoupling. Parameters which influence carbon dioxide elimination do not have any influence on oxygenation. And the reverse is also true. The parameters which are responsible for oxygenation, they are not doing anything with carbon dioxide. So it makes our life easy, right? So they have been totally demonstrated to be decoupled. So very clearly we know if you have a blood gas, so if there is an abnormality in oxygen, we have to play with MAP and FAO2. If there is an abnormality in CO2, we have to play with the amplitude, and hardly frequency is touched. That's it. That's all the changes that we want you to know and do with a high frequency ventilator. Okay. So frequency, again, I said, we are using a wide range of frequency, and the most commonly we use frequencies between 5 to 15. But you just choose one frequency to start with and then stay on that frequency. But the number we choose may be a little bit different between preterms and terms. So this graph explains what are the reason behind that. Reason is very simple. Every tissue has got some natural resonance. Okay, so the natural resonance of a preterm HMD lung is somewhat different. It is close to 13 to 15, whereas the natural resistance of a term lung is lower, between 8 to 10, and even lower down when we have PAEs and we have meconium aspiration syndrome like that. So in these conditions, we can choose a frequency of something like 8 to 10, whereas we have a preterm lung, especially with HMD, we can be operating on a higher frequency. But this is for the frequency on which we start the lung. So you don't need to touch the frequency based upon CO2, just play only with amplitude, that is enough. Okay. So we have just only some two small topics left. We have finished nearly 80% of our topic. Tejo, just remind me if I have only a few minutes left. Hardly, I should not take more than 5 or say 7 minutes from this point. Hope that's okay. So let's get into the strategies of high frequency, clinical strategies. What are the, we have discussed the various types of ventilators, the mechanisms, and what are the parameters to play around. Now, what do you mean by strategy here? Strategy is mainly about what kind of mean airway pressure are we going to use up. There are only two major strategies. One is called a high volume strategy, and the other is called a low volume strategy. So what do you mean by high volume strategy? That means when you are moving from conventional ventilation to high frequency ventilation, most of the times the lung is atelectated, right? That is the likely indication where you are going to just move from. And despite using higher pressures, you are not able to keep the alveoli open because the lung is very, very bad. So in that state, we want to use a little bit even higher pressures, and we want to start with a more open lung, what we call as a high volume strategy. So this high and low are relative to the pressures and volumes what the lung or the alveoli was experiencing in a conventional ventilator. So it's a relative term. So if you're trying to start with a little bit higher volumes than what it was there in conventional, we call it as a high volume strategy. If you want to start a high frequency with a low volume, that's called a low volume strategy. Fine. So when there is there are many indications. Hardly we use high frequency as a elective mode, but there are very few units in the globe who are using still high frequency as a primary mode. But most of the people, including our unit, we use only as a rescue mode. That means when we are not happy with conventional ventilator, or when we are operating on very high pressures, or the baby is still having difficulty in maintaining its carbon dioxide elimination or oxygen saturation in a conventional ventilator, that's the time we move to high frequency. That is what we call as a rescue mode. Most of the time it's a failure of conventional ventilation. And one of the commonest scenarios where this happens is a bad MAS or sometimes again a severe PPH. Okay. So when you think about this low volume or high volume strategy, it's always a good idea to think about what are the kind of disease that I am dealing with underneath. Most of the time we'll be dealing with homogeneous lung disease. You all know what we mean by homogeneous, right? RDS is a homogeneous disease. Even a pneumonia, especially a bad pneumonia to a larger extent, is a homogeneous disease in neonate. TTN is a homogeneous disease. Pulmonary edema, pulmonary hemorrhage. Most of the conditions what we're dealing with are affecting all parts of the lung, more or less in the same way. That's what we call as a homogeneous lung disease. What is a heterogeneous lung disease? So it's a patchy disease. It affects different parts of the lungs in a different way. There could be problems in patchily involving the airways. So wherever the airway is fully blocked, the lung is going for a collapse. Wherever the airway is partially collapsed, there is a trapping mechanism leading to overdistension. So it's a mix-up, combination of atelectasis, overdistension, so here and there. That is what we call as a heterogeneous lung. So atelectasis is a typical example of a homogeneous disease, whereas an air leak, meconium aspiration, all these are examples of heterogeneous lung diseases. So why we need to understand? So the think for want of time, okay, even though this is not 100% applicable, I'll say that whenever you're dealing with a homogeneous lung disease, it's better to adopt a high volume strategy of a high frequency ventilation. And whenever we are dealing with a heterogeneous lung disease like an air leak, it's better to operate as a low volume strategy. So that I think is, if you remember this point, that's enough for the moment. So simply speaking, high volume strategy is about starting with a MAP 1-3 centimeter higher than what was the MAP on IMB. Okay, so I said choose a fixed MAP between 8-12. Inspiratory time is 33%. These are all standards which we don't touch upon. So how do we adjust the amplitude? Amplitude is again the simplest parameter to adjust. So amplitude produces oscillations, right? So that oscillation should be visible on the chest of the baby. So, but we just look into how far those oscillations are present on the baby's chest. So we want the oscillations to be there up to the level of umbilicus, not beyond the umbilicus. If you do have the vibrations of the chest seen beyond umbilicus, that means you are operating at a higher amplitude. If the oscillations are not at all visible or they are not up to the level of umbilicus, they are present only over the chest, that's time for you to increase the amplitude. So what is the bottom line? Amplitude would go by the oscillations of the chest and the upper abdomen. The optimal oscillation is vibrations happening only up to the level of umbilicus. Okay. Okay, just only 1 minute I'll spend on this method. So if you're really interested in, okay, rather than just simply adopting a high volume strategy or a low volume strategy, if you're a purist, if you just want to find out for the given lung, what is the exact pressure or the mean airway pressure likely, which will be the optimum pressure for a given baby, for a given lung. So you can do an experiment, which many units who follow high frequency ventilation follow, they use it. A simple strategy. First, let's start with some lower pressures and let's have a saturation target of only 86-94%. Okay, that means a lower pressures at which you are not having a very high saturation, you are just having a borderline saturation. So then from that point onwards, you start increasing the mean airway pressure in a high frequency ventilator in terms of what? 1-2 centimeter every 2-3 minutes in slow term. Don't hurry. One, make a change of one, wait for 2 minutes, then you make a change of another one, increase. Till what point? Till the saturation keeps increasing. Till you reach a point where the saturation is no longer increasing. Okay. As long as the point at which you start sensing the raise in saturation whenever the pressure is raised, that is the opening pressure. Okay. So you may, let's say, let's just talk with examples that may be easy to understand. Let's say I'm starting with a mean airway pressure of something like 8. I'm moving to 9, I'm not finding any raise in saturation. When I'm moving to 10, I'm finding a raise in saturation. So I know that this is the point where the alveoli are remaining to open up well. That's what we call as an opening pressure. Okay, proceed further. You make it 11, you make it 12, you keep on increasing till you don't find any further increase in saturation, and actually, in fact, the saturation starts falling. Let's say up to when I had 11, actually the saturation still became better, but maybe when I went to 12, the saturation still starts falling. From 95, it becomes 94 or 93. That is the maximal pressure. Okay, no point in, you have reached the maximum. Then you reverse the process. So you come down on the pressure slowly one by one till the saturation falls and find out what is the closing pressure. So you now you know these three pressures, where for this given lung, what is the opening pressure of this lung, what is the maximum pressure for total lung, where total lung volume is achieved, and then you know something like a closing pressure also, at that the pressure at which the alveoli starts going into collapse. So where is the optimal pressure lying? So the optimal pressure is just around 2 centimeters above the opening pressure. We don't want to operate exactly at the opening pressure. So you go to the opening pressure and just use a 2 centimeter water pressure over that of the opening pressure. That is the exact pressure at which you are going to remain there. That's an optimal pressure is all about. Okay. Okay. Some troubleshooting. Quick run through troubleshooting. We all know what to do. So again, whenever there is oxygenation is not happening good, X-ray is a very very important tool to assess the volume of the lung. You may have to do some repeated X-rays, unlike in conventional ventilation, to see whether, because we want the lung to be optimally inflated, neither over distension nor atelectasis. So X-ray plays a big role. If the lungs are not open in the X-ray or oxygenation is not happening well, we'll be increasing the pressures by 1 to 2. And so, but if you are in the X-ray, if the lung is well extended, but if the oxygenation is not happening, what does it mean? But there is no problem in CO2. That means you are over distant. Lung is already over distant. That's why the oxygenation is not happening. You are going towards the maximum pressure, what we're talking about, total lung capacity. So that is a time when you have to decrease your pressure by 1 to 2. Okay. Okay. Whenever there is a problem in CO2, play simply with amplitude. Hypercarbia, increase the amplitude. Hypocarbia, decrease the amplitude. Not much. Don't you touch the frequency at all. Whenever you have a hyperoxia, the first parameter you should be touching is an FiO2. Then you will move towards decreasing the pressures. If the chest is not wiggling well, think about most likely first see rule out airway blocks. Make sure the airway is open. Do a good suctioning. Sometimes it could be a chest wall edema or a rigidity, rarely. Okay. So you have to take appropriate steps in those situations. Okay, again, as I'm exceeding time, I'm just skipping some questions. If it's there in the chat box, I'm just moving to evidence. I'd like to summarize the evidence in just in 1 or 2 slides. I don't want to bore you with more evidence. At the moment, all that we can say is that even though by its principles, high frequency ventilation is a very, very lung friendly and lung protective method of ventilation, we don't have a hard evidence or to consider high frequency ventilation. There is no evidence to say that high frequency ventilation is superior to conventional ventilation in terms of what to say, hard outcomes like decreased duration of ventilation, mortality, incidence of bronchopulmonary dysplasia or anything. Just okay. So if you look into the incidence of CLD, there are some small reduction that is achieved. That's what the Cochrane says, but there is an increased risk of air leaks. So that's why this is in comparison to conventional ventilation. So that is maybe that's one of the reasons why the benefit is getting offset. Okay. So let's move further. In a nutshell, when you're talking about high frequency in a preterm, there are many trials only for elective ventilation, about 19 trials, but they all actually they are saying that the CLD is less, but there are higher forms of adverse effects happening, higher IVH, PVL, and air leak. Okay, rescue, there is only one trial, so most of the time still we are just going to we are all using high frequency only as a rescue mode, not as a primary mode. So last 2 or 3 slides, just only a recap. So what have we learnt by evidence? There is a big difference between what to say, going by the nature or the principles in which high frequency work. It is supposed to protect the lung a lot, but we are actually not achieving those benefits. More so in a preterm, maybe because these oscillations and high distending pressures are increasing the risk of air leak, and they may bring in some changes in the cerebral vascular perfusion. That might be the likely explanation for the increase enough intraventral hemorrhage and PVL that is happening later. So that might offset the benefits what we are getting from a conventional ventilator. So we are not using it as a primary mode. We can go only when it is a rescue mode. So rather than just trying to, rather than asking this question, which is a better type of ventilation, conventional or high frequency, the answer is straightforward. Okay, so one is not superior over the other. What is the message then? So these two are totally different ventilator strategies. That comes in more handy when one mode of ventilation is conventional. When the strategy fails, then you just please consider high frequency. So the strategy is more decided by the patient characteristics and the disease characteristics rather than just simply saying whether high frequency is the first choice or conventional ventilation is the first choice. So it's more in the minds of the person who is ventilating to choose the right kind of ventilation, use the right strategy, rather than just looking to the best ventilator. And high frequency is definitely is one more weapon in our armamentarium when we are dealing with very bad lung and when conventional ventilation is not working well. I think I'll stop here, Tejo. If there are questions, I'll take it up.
Thank you, Dr. Mandalwati sir. There are a few questions. One is that, what is meant by DCO2?
Yeah, that is okay. I'm not going into the detail. So high frequency ventilator has got some way of estimating the minute ventilation. So how much gas exchange happens over a period of minute. So this is an indicator that the machine uses to show you the changes in CO2. Ultimately, what do you mean by the changes in CO2? Changes in CO2 is a reflection of the minute ventilation, what is happening. So based upon DCO2, you can have some idea about the minute ventilation happening in that particular lung.
Is there any correlation between the CO2? That's what they asked. I think you told that already. It reflects the ventilation, minute ventilation.
Yeah.
Second one is that, can we use HFO as a primary mode in the CDH? I think this also.
Yeah, so as of now, there is no clinical indication where people are preferring high frequency as their primary mode. But having said that, I have also said there are very few units who believe strongly in this strategy and they are using high frequency as primary mode even for management of RDS. There are such units in the world, very few units. So what is most important is that the strategy, what you are going to use and the strategy you are comfortable with and your understanding about the underlying lung problem rather than the ventilator per se. But for us who are used to conventional ventilators for a long time, especially after these volume targeted ventilation facilities are available, where we can easily just understand these things rather than choosing some other mode of ventilation which is a totally unconventional one where everyone may not be very familiar with how to handle these various parameters, I will vouch for or vote for staying on conventional ventilators and bringing in more and more volume targeted strategies and lung protective strategies. Only if that fails, you can opt or go for high frequency. But the reverse is also true. Whenever high frequency is not working, come back to conventional. Doesn't mean that you will have to stay on high frequency. High frequency also may not work in a baby. So don't hesitate to come back to conventional when high frequency is not working.
Okay. I think you touched the last point very nicely, that we should be relying on our own conventional ventilation also. Delta P in SLE, what does it mean by, I think?
Delta P in SLE?
SLE.
Sorry, if you're using SLE, you can answer that question, Tejo. I don't have first-hand experience with SLE.
Simply amplitude only, there is nothing much.
Okay.
So, amplitude is a delta. So, how to choose amplitude? I think you have already told about it. You need to look at vibration still, good vibrating chest and other things. That's all. I think more or less, is that any... If there are nothing, I think we'll go ahead with the next session, that is the case discussion. Okay. Srinivas sir? Srinivas sir, are you there? So while we are doing the things, maybe you can take 2 minutes break so that we'll all join in the breakout room sessions. I'll just call, sir, and then start the process. One second. request the faculty whether to check whether they are co-host or not. If not, please let me know in the chat box. I will start making them co-host. Most of them have made already. Just wanted to know. Once you are co-host, Femita is to be done. I am making her. Anyone more?